Hello, I'm Dr. Aizaz from medicovisual.com, and in today's visual lecture, we will talk about development of salivary glands. And by salivary glands, I mean the major salivary glands. We have three types of major salivary glands: the parotid glands, the sublingual glands, and the submandibular glands. I am saying glands because they are paired structures. They are present bilaterally. These are the major salivary glands, but besides these major salivary glands, some small minor glands are present all over the pharynx and mouth and at many different places throughout your oral cavity. We will not talk about those because to be honest, we do not know much about the development and even the structure of those minor salivary glands. So let's talk about the development of major salivary glands. Now, to understand this, please understand this diagram, that here is the cut section of this is the frontonasal prominence, and here is the cut section of first pharyngeal arch. This is the maxillary prominence and this is the mandibular prominence. Both of the prominences are shown here, and here you can see, let me exactly show you, that somewhat here is this place called landmark called oropharyngeal membrane. And you must already be knowing that at oropharyngeal membrane and at the cloacal membrane, at these two places, the ectoderm and endoderm, they are closely opposed together, and there is almost no mesoderm in between them. That here is the ectoderm from outside, and from inside there is the mesoderm, and in between them there is little to no mesoderm. So basically there are only these two layers that are stitched together at the cloacal membrane and at the oropharyngeal membrane. Now, what is the stomodium? There is another structure that many students, they confuse. Please note down that the oropharyngeal membrane is different from the oropharyngeal membrane is not stomodium. Stomodium is a different structure. This is very important concept that you must understand. Now, what is stomodium? Stomodium is also labeled almost at this place in textbooks, because the site of labeling of stomodium as well as oropharyngeal membrane is same in textbooks. That's why many students get confused, but you must not get confused. Actually, here at the site of oropharyngeal membrane, the ectoderm is depressed. If I show you from side, here you can see that, yeah, so if you look it at from an angle, you can see that the ectoderm is slightly depressed at this point where the oropharyngeal membrane is there. So this ectodermal depression is called stomodium. So stomodium is ectodermal structure. It is basically the depression of ectoderm at the site of oropharyngeal membrane. But oropharyngeal membrane is basically a thin membrane which is basically a bilayered structure. It consists of ectoderm from outside. Superficially, it consists of ectoderm, and the deeper layer is formed by the endoderm. If I draw a two-dimensional structure to make you understand this, that here is the ectoderm, and ectoderm is going like this. It is depressed here. It is forming a depression here, and from inside there will be the endoderm. Endoderm like this here. Now, at most of the places, I haven't shown in this 3D model, by the way, at most of the places there will be mesoderm in between the ecto and endoderm. So mesenchymal mesoderm is there, and here there will be little to no mesoderm. Now, this membrane that has been formed, this membrane only, it is called oropharyngeal membrane. But this depression, this ectodermal depression here, this depression is actually the stomodium. Now, this depression or stomodium is actually the primordium of some of the important components and especially it is the primordium of your mouth of the embryo, not your mouth. Of course, your mouth also was also once derived by the stomodium, but I am currently talking about the embryo. So stomodium and oropharyngeal membrane. Now at the angles of stomodium, the ectodermal buds form, ectodermal or epithelial buds, they form, they proliferate, and they you can say they bud out from here. Let me show you the animation that these ectodermal buds, they will proliferate, they will come out, they will bud out like this, and they will be forming the parotid gland. And we will see how they form later, but they will be forming the parotid gland. Now regarding the other two glands, the sublingual and the submandibular gland, they form from the endoderm. So here is this endodermal tube. So here it will be actually forming the floor of mouth. So from here also endodermal buds. So endodermal buds arise. Now there is a single bud here, and then there are some small buds, they also arise. The single bud is going to form the submandibular gland, and along with that this main part it will be forming the duct of submandibular gland, while these small ducts, they will form the sublingual gland. Now how these glands form, and we will discuss that later in this lecture. Now what will happen, that this oropharyngeal membrane, it will begin to disintegrate, right? So it will be destroyed, and this bilayered structure will be lost, and ultimately we have this connection here. So you can see now, if I try to go inside, I can go inside this tube, and this tube will form esophagus, and it will also be forming the trachea and some part of pharynx and the floor of mouth. So now what I will do is that I will show you the adult derivatives of these structures, the ectoderm and endoderm. We have already discussed their development in the previous lectures, so no need to go into details, but let's just watch a quick morph animation. So now here you can see the adult derivatives of these structures. Let's hide this part. I have removed this part, and now you can see that here the stomodium has formed a skin, the outer skin, and the enamel of teeth, this hard part. Basically it's a white, but I have deliberately shown it in the blue color so that you can understand, you will know that the enamel of tooth is derived from the ectoderm. So the upper and lower lips, they are also derived from this ectoderm, and the enamel of teeth, and the cheeks. The cheeks are derived from the ectoderm, while the floor of mouth, here I have removed this. So the floor of mouth, it is derived from the endoderm, right? So here was the stomodium, right? The stomodium got transformed into upper lip like this, and enamel of tooth like this, enamel of tooth, right? And of course then what happened here the nasopharynx, right? Nasopharynx, and here the floor of mouth, and then it will continue as esophagus and trachea forward here, and esophagus, and of course here will be larynx as well. So these structures are derived from the endoderm, but the upper lip, enamel of tooth, upper and lower lip, enamel of tooth, and cheeks, they are derived from the ectoderm. And along with that, of course, from the maxillary process, here there will be the hard palate, which I haven't shown in this 3D model, and soft palate as well. But here you got the idea. Now I will go into that model to make you understand a few important concepts. So basically what happened, that because it was derived, the parotid gland it was derived from the stomodium, from the angle of stomodium. Here you can see from the angle of stomodium, and this angle of stomodium, it is going to form the cheek, and so it is basically forming the posterior most part of the cheek. So that is why it is opening this part, it is opening this duct, basically it is opening into this, into the cheek, opposite to second molar tooth. I will show you in a moment. And this distal part, basically it is the parotid gland. So here, if I show you here, you can see that here is the first and second. Yes, so here is the second molar tooth, and yeah, if I go deeper, here is the cheek opposite to second molar tooth, and here you can see here is the opening of parotid duct. So because of this unique embryonic origin, the opening of the parotid gland, basically the opening of parotid duct, is opposite to the second molar tooth, and this opening is in the cheek, in the buccal area in the cheek, while the opening of the sublingual glands as well as the submandibular gland, these openings are into the floor of mouth, which is actually the endodermal in origin. And by the way, this is myelohyoid muscle, right? So myelohyoid muscle, it actually divides the submandibular gland. This is submandibular gland. It is divided into superficial and deeper part. This is the deeper part, this is superficial part, by this myelohyoid muscle. These things you will learn in anatomy, hopefully. And here is this gland called sublingual gland, which is also opening into the floor of your mouth. So that's how. And by the way, the sublingual gland, it has multiple ducts, multiple tiny small ducts that open again into the floor of mouth at the sides of your tongue. Of course, here there will be tongue, which I haven't shown. So it will open into the tongue. And of course, here we have the esophagus and trachea, and I haven't shown the larynx here. Let's remove this other side as well to make you really see these structures. I hope you can see. By the way, sublingual gland is superior, it is superiorly lying to this myelohyoid muscle. It is basically deeper to the myelohyoid muscle. So I hope you can understand these things. Well, this development of salivary gland, it is not very complicated topic, it's easy to understand. Now if we briefly talk about the development of this glands, it's very simple, and it is similar to most of the other glands in your body. So basically what happens that here is that epithelial cord or epithelial bud that arises, and this epithelial bud, for example, this is blue in color, so it's actually it's not blue. Ectoderm is not blue, it is just for the sake of representation. So this ectoderm, this is ectodermal bud, so that is why it is parotid gland. So this bud arises, then what will happen that it will divide like this, and it will divide, and it will continue to divide to form the compound gland, and their end will become globular. They will become club shaped like this. They will become globular, and in this way the basic architecture of the gland is formed. Now surrounding this basic architecture, we have the mesoderm. All around we have the mesoderm. So this mesoderm, what it will do is that it will form the connective tissue surrounding this gland, and it will also form the capsule of the gland, and this capsule will form lobular appearance. It will partially divide the gland into these types of lobes. So that is why these glands, they have such lobulated appearance. So the outer capsule as well as the connective tissue, it is derived from the mesoderm, right? While the basic epithelial architecture, the basic parenchymal architecture I should say, it is derived from ectoderm in case of parotid gland, while in case of the submandibular and sublingual gland, it is derived from the endoderm. This process in which there is the formation of this bud, and this bud then divides and it branches and it continues to form ultimately the compound gland. This type of development is called branching morphogenesis. What it is called? It is called branching morphogenesis. Now basically regarding the development of these glands, these salivary glands, two things that you must know. If you want to forget everything of this lecture, please remember only two things: that parotid gland is derived from the ectoderm, mainly derived, of course there is the role of mesoderm as well that I have already discussed. So parotid gland is mainly derived from the ectoderm, while sublingual and submandibular gland, they are derived from the endoderm. One thing you must know: the origin, what is the origin, from which layer they originate, and second, that how they develop. Basically they divide and subdivide, and this is called branching morphogenesis. Another important point is that basically initially they are the solid cords like this. They are solid cords, these are not hollow, right? So these are the solid cords like this. But later what happens, that from inside they are like this. These cells, they undergo apoptosis, programmed cell death, they die out, and hence they become hollow. So this is a common trend in embryology, and I don't know why it happens. This is, by the way, called recanalization, and it's very common. It's not unique to salivary gland, it's a common trend in embryology. And exactly why it happens, to be honest, I don't know. If you know this, please let me know as well. And finally, let's see how these glands look like. Now, in this visual lecture, I am not going into details of histology of these glands, but the basic 3D overview you can see in this 3D model, that it's a compound gland and there are acini at the ends, these club shapes, and they will be forming the secretory, the actual secretory part, which will secrete the saliva into these ducts, and ultimately these ducts will drain the saliva in your oral cavity, in your mouth. So this is the basic structure of your salivary glands. So yeah, I hope you can understand. And this parenchyma, it is again derived from ectoderm in case of parotid, and in case of other two glands, it is derived from the endoderm. And of course, another type of cells are also there, which I haven't shown in this diagram, in this 3D model. The myoepithelial cells are also there. And to be honest, I don't know what is the embryonic origin of those myoepithelial cells in the salivary glands. I read this topic from about 20 books of embryology, but honestly, I could not find the origin of myoepithelial cells of the salivary gland. So this is what it is. Hopefully this will not be asked in your exam. And by the way, if you know what is the origin of myoepithelial cells of the salivary gland, please do let me know in the comment section below. So thank you so much for watching this video. Have a great day. And meanwhile, you can enjoy this model as well. Isn't it beautiful?